From Buck Island Studios in lovely West Yarmouth, Massachusetts, it's the Liberty Freelance with Dr. Lindeman podcast. On today's episode, I'm going to tell you about an article from makeuseof.com about how to deal with difficult freelance clients. I'm going to tell you about a documentary that I just saw, which is actually almost six years old, and I'm going to tell you about both of those things. But first, I need to tell you this. So this fly buzzes into a bar, and he asks one of the guys sitting at the bar, "Is this stool taken?" Of course, the best way to ruin a joke is to explain it. So instead, I'm going to tell you about Betting on Zero, a documentary that was made by Ted Braun, B-R-A-U-N, in 2016. Ted Braun is quite an accomplished documentarian. He's best known for Darfur Now. And let's see, what else has he done? Baghdad to Hollywood. And in 2016, he made a documentary called Betting on Zero. Now, Betting on Zero tells the story about a large multi-level marketing company, international, called Herbalife, curiously referred to as Herbalife by many in the film, including some involved with the company, and a Wall Street financier named Bill Ackman, A-C-K-M-A-N, who in 2012 took out a short position on Herbalife, meaning he was betting that the company was going to fail. Primarily because he was hoping to expose Herbalife as a pyramid scheme, which it is. It's permitted to operate legally in the United States for long, complicated reasons, which have to do with the history of the Federal Trade Commission, Amway, regulatory capture, and a lot of things, but I don't want to distract too much from the topic at hand. The even though Ackman was correct and was in the right, the mistake that he made is that he brought a moral crusade to Wall Street, and Wall Street has no morals. Wall Street is about making money. Herbalife is a publicly traded company. Even though they publish their income disclosure statement, and anybody who reads it can see for themselves that getting involved with the company as a distributor is a losing proposition, but people do it anyway. That aside, Wall Street is not a good place to wage your campaign. I happened to watch Betting on Zero the same night that I rewatched for the third or fourth time The Big Short, which is another story about a short sell for a fraudulent enterprise, which in this case was much larger, which was the United States housing market. A little bit different, you know, there were some individuals who took the time to notice that the subprime mortgage market combined with well-meaning but misguided governmental policies regarding mortgage lending led to the ultimate collapse in the housing market. Some people realized this, short sold it, and ended up making a lot of money at the expense, not at the expense of the American public or the world economy, but they saw it coming and they benefited from it. Ackman actually was hoping to bring Herbalife down and probably the whole multi-level market industry. The reason he failed primarily was because of another Wall Street financier who happened to have beef with Bill Ackman. Hated him, in fact. His name was Carl Icahn, is Carl Icahn, I-C-A-H-N. And Icahn placed a counter bet, so to speak, invested a lot of money in Ackman. And basically, at the end of the day, Ackman and his investment firm lost about $1 billion. Well, a little bit less than $1 billion, billion with a B, betting against Herbalife. Herbalife is a very large, very powerful, very well-connected company. When you run with the big dogs, you better have long legs. And Bill Ackman's legs weren't long enough, and he lost. And that is a tragedy. But Ted Braun has told the story in affecting style, and it's a highly recommend. Watch that. Watch The Big Short. And if you are able to find the original The Dream podcast, please watch it. Please listen to it. I'm unable to find it. I may have to look for it on YouTube. There is a second chapter, so to speak, which is available on podcast right now. Let me tell you about now a terrific article that I read in makeuseof.com called How to Deal with Difficult Freelance Clients, Six Ways. And I'm just going to read you the six tips that they give, which are extremely useful to me and hopefully will be useful to you. Number one, set clear boundaries. Before you start working with a client, it is essential that both parties set their expectations from the beginning. In many cases, freelancers develop toxic relationships with the people they work with because they and their clients aren't on the same page. When you start a project, the client will often send agreements that you'll both need to sign before commencing with the work. And to protect yourself, you must do the same. In your contracts, it's a good idea to outline each of the following: the hours that you'll be available, how many free revisions the client gets, and fees that they'll incur for late payments. I confess, I do only one of these three things. That is how many free revisions the clients get. In my case, unlimited, because generally they only send it back to me once. The median number of times that someone sends a paper back to me is zero. I don't set limits on hours, and I should, and by golly, some clients abuse that. Now, the article points out that Fiverr Workspace does allow you to create contacts, and that's a terrific tool. But you can write them up yourself using Microsoft Word. Number two, use empathy. When a client doesn't agree with you on something, it's easy to feel like they have personally attacked you. In some cases, you might even start to doubt your abilities and whether or not you're cut out to be a freelancer. But before you respond with a passive-aggressive comment, try to take a step back and think about things from their perspective. It might be that the client had a different idea for the final product, or that you tried to innovate, but it didn't work. After you've understood why they're annoyed, explain why you took the approach that you did. It's likely that both of you will learn something from the experience and that you'll avoid such problems from resurfacing in the future. Number three, use software to chase up on payments. Great tip. I use QuickBooks. When someone is delinquent, I send them reminders and I keep doing it until they pay. And most of the time it works. Number four, accept feedback, but not bullying. Constructive feedback can help you improve your future projects to deliver better quality work and eventually find higher paying clients. And not every bit of client feedback is a direct attack on how good you are as a freelancer. Having said that, the key word is constructive, and there's a big difference between that and being outright disrespectful. If you notice that a client is consistently being rude to you, the worst thing that you can do is tolerate it. The worst thing you can do is tolerate it. The more you let it happen, the more it will continue. Instead, stand up for yourself and let them know you won't accept bullying under any circumstances. And if the client doesn't appreciate your concerns and continues acting in the same way, don't hesitate to fire them. I love that piece of advice. Number five. Remain professional. When you feel like a client is constantly out to get you, it's all too tempting to lash out and give them a taste of their own medicine. However, doing so is the worst thing you can do. At best, you destroy the relationship beyond repair. At worst, you ruin your industry reputation and limit your future prospects. In other words, treat others as you want to be treated. And finally, number 6, avoid working with them. When you become a freelancer, you quickly realize that some relationships don't work out regardless of how hard you try. If you've attempted to remain professional but your client refuses to meet you in the middle, you might have no choice but to let them go. All really good pieces of advice at makeuseof.com, how to deal with difficult freelance clients. Well, folks, that's all I've got for you today. Before I regale you with the 26 seconds that are most exciting in the history of rock and roll, I want to wish you the best of Thanksgivings. Be good to yourselves and each other.